Welcome to our review of MonsDRAWsity from Friendly Skeleton.
MonsDRAWsity comes from designer Eric Slosson and features artwork from a variety of different artists that I'm not all going to list here. It was originally released in 2020, and the version we own was published by Deepwater Games, who have since changed their name to Friendly Skeleton.
No, the version of MonsDRAWsity we're talking about tonight is the original version. There was a second edition, which was released in 2022, as well as MonsDRAWsity Top Secret, which was originally a Target exclusive. The basic gameplay is the same in all versions of the game, and what we say here will apply to all of them, but each version does feature different monster cards.
Now, there's also several expansions and a number of promos, each of which just gives you more monster cards with even more decks coming.
This party game plays 3-8 players at least, according to the box, though we've seen online games with many more people playing. Each round of the game only lasts 3 to 5 minutes total, with the full game length varying based on the player count and how long you want to play. As for what age this game is for, the box says 8, and the BGG community says 6. While we would say the gameplay is simple enough for the younger kids, the artwork may be scary or gory for some kids.
Now, MonsDRAWsity is a monster drawing game, as you can probably guess from the name. One player is the witness who saw a monster. That's represented by a card. They get to look at that card for a bit, but then they have to put it away and describe what they saw to the other players, who are sketch artists. Artists have 2 minutes to draw and ask the witness questions, and then everyone's drawing is revealed. You vote to determine whose drawing best matches the original card.
So for a look at a sample monster card and the other components you get in this drawing party game, we invite you to take a look at our MonsDRAWsity unboxing video on YouTube.
Now, I make sure to only show off one monster there because I don't want to spoil the fun. One of the reasons there are so many different versions and expansions and promos for this game is that it really does work best if none of the players have any familiarity with the monsters they may see.
Now, what you will see here is the very clear rulebook, a dry erase score tracker, all of which clean up very easily, as well as dry erase boards for the players. The markers and the box, which does a good job of storing everything. There's even extra room for additional cards, which we like to use to split up what cards we have and haven't used in games ourselves yet. Oh, and you get a sticker.
Now, the component quality here is honestly really good for a party game. Card quality is excellent. The card art is fantastic, though can get a bit creepy at times. More about that in a bit. One thing you don't get, though, is any form of timer. No sand timer here. You're going to need something to keep track of both the time the witness has to look at the card as well as the drawing time.
We gave a brief summary already, but I think it's worth giving a more detailed overview of play.
Note, this is not meant to be a teach. Please refer to the rule book in the game or someone who does teach videos to learn properly how to play the game. Though we're pretty much going to cover everything. I just don't want to be called out for messing up a rule. So you start a game of MonsDRAWsity by choosing who's going to be the first witness. They're going to take the deck of monster cards, and everyone else is going to grab a dry erase board and a marker.
The witness draws a monster card from the deck and has 20 seconds to look at it to try and memorize as many features as they can. After this time limit, a new timer is set, this time for 2 minutes, and the witness describes the monster they saw. Note, this has to be completely verbal. The witness is not allowed to include any hand gestures or anything like that.
Now, the other players are the sketch artists. They're going to do their best to draw what the witness is describing. Now, during this period, they are also free to ask the witness any questions they want to help them with their drawings. Now, while this is happening, be aware that no one should be able to see what anyone else is drawing. And the witness can't refer back to their card while describing what they saw. It's got to be all from memory.
After the 2-minute timer, the artists all reveal their drawings. The witness notes down who they think both best matched their memory of the card without checking the card. It has to be from their memory.
Then the monster card is revealed, and the artists now vote for who they think best drew the monster on the card. The player or players, if you tie, have the most votes, each get a point.
The witness then reveals their pick. If they pick the same one as the artist voted for, they're considered a credible witness, and they get 1 point. If they picked someone else, that player gets the point instead.
You then pass the deck of cards to the next player, they become the next witness, and you keep going around. Now, according to the rule book, you're supposed to let every player play the witness twice. That's the official full game rules. In practice, though, we found some groups are happy going around the table once. Other groups just keep playing round after round after round.
Now, the rule book also includes one variant where the witness doesn't just start describing the monster. The artists have to ask the witness questions, and the witness can only answer based on the questions asked. When using this variant, you get 3 minutes to draw and question instead of two.
Now, I think I first heard about this game during a Gen Con spring showcase. This was in the middle of the COVID lockdowns. And as soon as I heard the game they described, as soon as I heard what this game was about, I had to have it. Then I watched an actual play with 30 or so players drawing what the streamer witness was describing and commenting. It just cemented in my head how much I think this would be a great game to play with my family. Both my kids are aspiring artists. My one daughter wants to grow up to be a children's book illustrator. The other one just draws drawing. I knew they were going to love it. And I also thought this would be fantastic for public play events.
Yeah, it was pretty clear that this game was going to be a winner with the party game crowd when I heard about it. But it remained to be seen what the artistic style was and how much artistic style mattered to players. Turns out, both more wide-ranging than expected and not that much, in that order.
Now, one of the things I love about this game is the simplicity. It is super approachable. You can describe the core concept in seconds, and from that base description, anyone you just give that pitch to is going to know right away, are they in or out? It's that simple. One player describes a monster, everyone else has to draw it, then you get points based on how close you were to the original. That's it. That's the entire concept of this game. Such a great concept, and it plays out pretty much exactly as you'd expect it to.
Yeah, the real magic behind this game is the art itself. It needs to be complex enough to challenge the witness, but still have readily describable features.
Now, something I found fascinating is how much the game evolves as you play. The experience changes the more you play the game. How much experience actually affects both being the witness and the person drawing, especially being the person drawing, what questions you will ask the witness. Because your first game of MonsDRAWsity as a witness, you don't really know what you should focus on. You got this card and there's this creepy, cute, whatever thing there. And you're like, man, I don't know what to do. What's the important part? What do I have to memorize? And you try to memorize it all. Well, as you play more rounds, you quickly learn that some things are more important than others. For example, I've almost every time someone plays for the first time, someone's going to mention a color on the monster. Well, everyone just has black dry erase markers on white whiteboards. So color doesn't matter at all. And usually it's a couple of rounds before people realize how important things are. Like, which way is the monster facing? Is it looking to the back? Is it looking to the front? So details are easy to remember. Like, oh, it had three arms. But what position were those arms in? And then the fact you can describe things like six eyes, everyone's going to catch that. But not everyone's going to catch, oh, it was crouched over, facing to its right, with its back arched upwards towards the sky. And it's long, so it's more of a lengthwise thing. It's a, you want to draw it landscape instead of portrait.
Of course, the longer you play, the more detailed your descriptions get, and the more artistry matters to the other players as well. First-time players may be happy to reward someone who has gotten the feel of the monster without getting that detail right, whereas the more you play, you're going to be looking for that closer accuracy often.
An experience with the game is also one of the drawbacks, right? Because as I mentioned earlier, to have the most fun with this game, you should be using a brand new, never before seen monster from anyone playing that round. You never want to have a round when someone's like, oh, I remember that monster. Or you don't want the witness to sit down with the players and go, yeah, remember that one that looks like a starfish? It's that one. That would completely ruin the fun of this game. Now, it is very easy to keep track if it's just you and your group or your family. And you use the box. The box even has a divider to separate your cards. So you just sit there and go, yep, there's the stack of cards we played. Here's the stack of cards we haven't touched yet. The problem is if you're someone like me whose copies of games get played by multiple people, or you bring them out to public play events, or even more so, my kids have taken this game to school. So they played it with different groups that I've never even played. So it's a little hard for us to keep track and find a card that no one in the family's used. Now, there are tons of expansions to help with this problem. So if you do have that mix up and you're like, man, I don't even know what we've seen or something, just grab a new pack. And to be fair, if a repeat does come up, if it's just one or two players, it's not going to ruin the round. And honestly, the way different witnesses describe the cards, you could have five different people describe the same monster completely different. So it doesn't ruin it. It's just better if every monster is fresh.
If you are someone who runs public play events, it might even be worth buying an expansion for only at home play, and leaving the main deck of the game for playing with various people out at events.
No, I totally agree. That makes perfect sense. Now, one problem that did come up when introducing this game to new players is that some of the artwork is a little creepy. And there are some insect-like creatures and some various arachnid-looking things. And some of the creatures just look downright vicious with, like, blades dripping with ichor. Now, I'm sure for most people, this isn't going to be a problem. The game is called MonsDRAWsity. You expect monsters. But I will say it was a little more striking than I expected. And you might want to check with the group you're playing with for any particular phobias. The first time we played with my youngest daughter, she ended up having nightmares after our first play based on the card art. Now, since then, she hasn't found another card. There was one particular card that she still doesn't ever want to see again. So this is one of the reasons I personally went out and picked up the Cute Creatures expansion, because it specifically avoids that. There's another Robots expansion that is also good for that. So you just need to check with your group.
As you can see in the box image down there, The art on the box makes it feel a little bit more cute than some of the monsters may appear to be. It is an impressive range of art that they have put together here, and it might be worthwhile having someone who's not interested in playing filter the cards if you do have people with concerns, just to avoid any surprises. The last thing anyone needs is to have their day ruined by a game.
Yeah, all I would do is do kind of like your normal RPG check-in at the start of the game and say, is there anything that you don't want to see? And then just make sure everyone's aware. And when they're the witness, if they happen to draw a card that features whatever crocodile-like things or things with more than two eyes, you throw it at the back of the deck for some other play. Now, in general, MonsDRAWsity was the hit I expected it to be. Yeah, my kids got a little creeped out by some of the pictures, and I can see how some people aren't going to like it. But overall, my kids adore this game. They love it. My gaming group loves this game. It's been a huge hit at our local game nights. And like I said, my kids have even brought this one to school. Even people who generally don't like drawing games have loved playing this one. And I think part of that is, even if you're not a great artist, the main thing is getting the gist across. The pose or motion or the arms in the right place is often way more important than the hair follicles being in the exact right spot. And sometimes that's going to work more than not perfectly matching the details on the cards.
I think in my experience playing this game, in their first game, actual artists, people with artistic skill, haven't done as well because they like to put the detail in. They like to get, and oftentimes they won't be able to finish, or they'll focus too much on a detail that no one else has cared about, which gives it to the other players, because overall the art seems to resemble it, even if the quality of the drawing is more stick finger than not for other people. Again, though, as they develop and they learn what is important and what isn't in the drawings and get to experience more of the monsters, it does improve, and their skill and their use of time gets a lot better.
Yeah, the other thing I've noticed with artists is that they spend a lot of time on the detail. Well, if the detail's wrong, it's very hard to score well. Whereas if you just drew like the abstract shape and kind of it, it's going to be close to the monster than this highly detailed creature that looks nothing like the card. Now, the one place that shocked me the most, where MonsDRAWsity has been the biggest hit locally, like I was totally surprised by this, is with the local Dungeons & Dragons community, especially the Dungeon Masters in that group. We've had a couple different D&D groups come out to our public play events, and after their game or before their game, they're looking for board games to play, and this is the one I would recommend to them. And I guess this makes perfect sense when you think about it, because one of the jobs of being a Dungeon Master in D&D or a GM in a fantasy game or anything else is describing the monsters. Like, one local DM specifically noted, this game is a fantastic way to practice and refine those monster description skills. And after playing MonsDRAWsity, they found their game got better the next time, you know, the heroes ran across the Great Grell. They were able to describe the Grell in much more striking fashion. This, honestly, in my opinion, is one of those games that could just be perfect for winning your RPG-only friends to play more, diversify, and play other types of games, play on a night. And it's perfect for your RPG group when someone can't make it and you don't want to continue your campaign. Or here's a great board game to suggest that isn't something you're going to get too involved in and possibly distract the group.
Well, it's not going to win over people who can't stand drawing games at all, I think your average group of players is going to have fun with this game regardless of their hobby gaming experience. This is actually a fantastic game for hobby gamers to bring out when hanging with non-gamers or extended family. There you have our thoughts on the monster drawing party game, MonsDRAWsity. There are quite a few popular drawing games out there now. We've come a long way from win, lose, or draw. What's your favorite drawing game? Let us know in the comments below.
If you enjoyed this review, how about you treat us to a coffee over at coffeeko-fi.com/tabletopbellhop. One word.